Now, this is the second of a set of webinars that we are going to show and produce in the next few months, and they are part of the initiative that we are jointly undertaking with the European Union under the INFORM program and its knowledge management platform. These webinars are produced essentially by DEFCO in collaboration with the resilience team of FAO. Let me take this opportunity also to briefly thank the colleagues from DEFCO, particularly from the Rural Development, Food Security and Nutrition Unit, and from the Knowledge Management Group. I mean, they have been extremely helpful, and we could have not organized this webinar without them. What I'm going to talk now, before introducing my colleague Marco Del Rico for his intervention, I want to just say a few things about resilience measurement, and maybe also quoting some of things I heard from some DEFCO colleagues. Now everyone is talking about resilience. You don't find anymore any development program that does not mention resilience, or politicians that do not mention resilience. Now the problem is, if you put yourself or myself in the shoes of a decision maker with limited resources, the point is, if everything is resilience, then nothing is resilience. So the point is that a tool like RIMA should help decision maker to make choice about, Marco will elaborate on this, but about what are the most urgent need to address, and how to go about building resilience, and most of all, important of all, is whether the public resources we are going to invest into resilience are well spent. These are the kind of strategic questions that we try to answer through the work that we are doing on resilience. Let me say two things before I give the floor to Marco. The first one is that resilience measurement and resilience analysis is of fundamental importance to FAO. We have one of the strategic objectives, which is organized around resilience, and for us it's absolutely crucial that our program is informed by good analysis, and we are making a lot of effort in making sure that resilience is mainstreamed within analysis, mainstream within FAO. We have a resilience strategy, a corporate approach to resilience measurement. But the real challenge is really to move from what we have been doing up to 1 or 2 years ago, which was essentially a number of very good analysis of resilience paper produced, to a phase in which we move from analysis to policy influence, because at the end of the day, this is what is FAO mandated, that is what our partners are expecting from us. So it's really on this that we want to concentrate, and on this we have to be extremely thankful also to our partner, the European Union, which has provided us resources through the INFORM initiative to move this thing forward at the country level. So let me move to give the floor to Marco. We have an agreement. He doesn't know, but I'll tell you. He cannot mention a number of words which I don't like idiosyncratic, covariate, and inferential. For the rest, he's free to say whatever he wants to say. Marco, the floor is yours.
Thank you, my dear boss. As you mentioned, I was not aware of this. I was not aware of this agreement, so but I'm fine with this, of course. So good afternoon to everybody. Thank you for coming and joining us in this webinar. And we'll see all these different aspects of the resilience on our resilience index measurement analysis that is called RIMA. So basically, we're going to go through five different aspects, and this is the outline of the presentation. So the first part will be looking at what we get, what you can get from a RIMA analysis. The second part will be what is the relation between resilience and RIMA too. The third one is the descriptive measure of RIMA. And the third part is the casual measure of RIMA, and I'm quite sure that I have everything on, so It's fine. And then finally, we will go through the stepping up of policy influence of RIMA analysis. So let's start with what you can get from RIMA. When we were started designing the RIMA tool, we had a certain level of questions in our head. The first question that we wanted to address is who is most in need? When we think about who is most in need, we think that we want to make sure that we are able to answer to who is most in need about between different subgroup of population of a population of interest. So, for example, if you can think about a gender perspective of resilience, then this means that you can ask in. You want to make sure to be able to see whether the female-headed household or the male-headed household are more or less resilient. Or, for example, what livelihood is more resilient compared to other type of livelihood strategies. The second question is where you should invest your efforts, your money, in terms of geographical location. So, for example, think about different regions, think about different geographical areas, think about different subdivision of the same area of interest. And an example comes to my mind is the example of the analysis that we are doing in Senegal, where, based on a resilience analysis, we focused our attention to the Matam region. Fine. Then we have a third question that is which dimension of resilience need to be supported. So we wanted a tool that was able to unpack the components of resilience in order to make sure that you can see the different combination of the different tools and how they contribute to the resilience capacity of a household or of your subject of interest. A key question for us is to what extent have interventions increased per target population's resilience, that is to say, what if our money is well spent or not. So we wanted a tool that is able to tell us the effectiveness of an intervention in one specific area. And finally, we want a tool that is able to tell us what are the main determinants of food security or resilience recovery. So we want to be able to follow a subsample of the population who register the loss in food security or in resilience and then manage to increase again its capacity. And we want to understand why and what were the main determinants. This is the first example that I want to give you. And it is an example based on an impact evaluation in Somalia. So around about 2012, a joint initiative was designed together between WFP, UNICEF, and FAO. This initiative was supposed to tackle poverty and resilience with a package of intervention that could incorporate the three different capacities and characteristics of the three agencies. The overall idea was that, okay, we are good at doing different things, but possibly it's better if we combine the efforts of the three agencies and we work together to deliver a better product. Therefore, we designed an impact evaluation which included a baseline analysis, a midterm analysis with two data collection in different regions, in different districts of Somalia. The design was made since the beginning, including sampling size, including the design of the questionnaires, and including the list of indicators that were supposed to be collected. Finally, we created also a control group in order to make the comparisons between the target group and the control group, and to make sure that we were finally able to attribute the impact of the project on specific indicators. And RIMA was employed as one of the indicators, as the indicator for detecting the impact. So as you can see from this graph here, the two curves on the left are the two curves detected in 2013 when the data collection started with the baseline analysis. So as you can see, there are two districts. One is Dolo, the other one is Luke. Dolo is the target group where the project was actually implemented, while Luke was taken as a control group. So the situation at the beginning in 2013 was that Dolo was a little bit less resilient than Luke. And if you see in the axis, in the x-axis, there is the resilience index. It ranges from 0 up to 1, where 0 is the low resilience and 1 is the highest possible level of resilience. The two curves on the right, they are still the resilience index, but for the 2015, that is to say, for the midterm evaluation that we recently completed. As you can see, there was a general improvement of the situation because both Dolo and Luke population increased the resilience capacity. But you may see that in Dolo, the increase was higher than in Luke. Therefore, by applying a propensity score matching technique, this word was not mentioned in the agreement, we managed to attribute the impact, the positive and significant impact of the joint resilience strategy program in Dolo in increasing resilience capacity of the households in Dolo. Of course, there were many contributors to this increase, which can be the support provided by WFP, UNICEF, and FAO into productive assets, in transfers, in access to infrastructure, and an increase of number of income sources, and on more general support to livelihoods that was provided to the households in Dolo. Another example of the impact evaluation that I want to mention to you is this example from a West Bank and Gaza Strip exercise that was done quite a number of years ago, like in 2011, if I'm not wrong. In this case, the design was just a before and after project implementation design. And here you can see how the different dimensions of resilience changed over time between the baseline and final evaluation, so between two different data collection exercises. Another interesting application of RIMA is with these maps here. In this case, the example is taken from the Triangle of Hope in Mauritania, where we are doing another exercise. So you may see on the left part, there is the map with the resilience index. On the right part of the slide, you have the poverty rate, and on the bottom part of the slide, you have the child malnutrition rate. This is just an example of one possible application of RIMA. Once you have the map on the resilience capacity, you can overlay this map with many other types of maps, with many other types of indicators. In fact, this is also part of one of the interaction that we are currently having with other agencies, with other subjects who are doing resilience analysis. And of course, for example, WFP exercise comes to my mind, where there are some overlapping of different maps. So this is, again, just an example. If you think about other possible maps, like a vegetation index, like agricultural stresses index, and many other type of indicators that currently exist in the literature in Africa and in many other countries, we can easily do overlay of maps that can provide further insights of the resilience situation and of security and food security situation. This is another example of what you can get from RIMA. This is one of the most interesting improvement of our communication strategy that we are recently been implementing. Basically, we are going to issue a policy brief together with each resilience analysis report that we are implementing. On the right part of this slide, you can see the infographic of this policy brief. So basically, this exercise was run under against a data set that was collected in Sudan in 2009 by the National Bureau of Statistics of Sudan. And we ran our resilience analysis, our RIMA, and based on the results of RIMA, we managed to see that the two regions from Darfur and Kordofan regions were the less resilient. And the reason why they were less resilient than the other regions in Sudan was exactly because of lower income, because of a worse access to food security, because of a worse access to electricity, and because of a worse access to safe water. Therefore, the consequence of this analysis can be that you can provide this population with specific inputs, which can be like the improvement of access to basic services and the improvement to water, to income generating activities. Another type of disaggregation analysis was on the gender differences. That is to say, we focused our attention to the household who are headed by female or headed by male. And in this case, it emerged that female-headed households are less resilient than male-headed households. And the reason why they are less resilient is because of lower income, of worse access to basic services, and on the lower level, educational level. Therefore, even in this case, it is possible to provide a wide array of indication, of policy indication, on how to improve food security of, resilience of the household that we are analyzing. Finally, this is just a list of the countries where we are currently doing, or where we have been doing, or where we have already done the analysis of RIMA. So you may see that we are covering many countries in the Sahel area, we are covering many countries in the Horn of Africa area, and we have a long list of ongoing projects in different countries in these two areas of Africa. We are also covering Chad, we are doing some impact evaluation in Lesotho, and of course we are doing many exercises on resilience measurement in West Bank and Gaza Strip, where the first resilience analysis took place in 2009. In many of these countries, there are a long list. There is a long list of collaboration between FAO and other agencies, and between FAO and other institution who is currently working on resilience. And I cannot forget to mention the example of the exercise that we are doing together with the regional initiatives like SEALS, like IGAD, but I want to mention this in a later slide ahead. So let's go and see a little bit further how RIMA fits into the resilience literature and how we think that the resilience can be measured through RIMA. So as I think that all of you are aware of, resilience is not directly measurable. So it is not something that you can go and buy in a shop, it's not something that you can obtain directly, it's not something that you can cultivate. At least we never tried. We can try to cultivate resilience. Maybe we can put a resilience report on in the ground and see what happens. However, resilience, measuring resilience is very, very, very much complicated, and there are many challenges. The first challenge is that resilience is a context-specific concept. It is very context-specific with respect to specific population of interest, with a specific outcome of interest, and with respect to specific shocks. So, for example, if you think about resilience capacity to food security is something. Resilience capacity to other type of outcome is something different. So you have to link resilience to a specific outcome. And based on what outcome you have in mind, the entire estimation process can change. Also, another very important and very key aspect of resilience measurement is that resilience should be on the right-hand side of the equation in order to measure the capacity of ensuring a certain level of an outcome. That is to say, on the left-hand side of the equation, the why should be like food security or consumption, and then we want to understand what are the key determinants in guaranteeing the recovery of food security, of a food security level. Finally, resilience is a quite time-dependent concept. It is very much time-dependent because resilience itself can change over time. Many of the variables who are included in every resilience framework are time-dependent. I mean, if you think about education is, of course, a variable which can have an effect on the long period, not in the short period. Or maybe education may have a bigger impact on resilience in the long term rather than in the short term. So all these aspects of time, and I was discussing with a friend of mine, a colleague of mine recently, and he ended up by saying it's all about time, in the sense that time is so much important for resilience. Finally, resilience can be estimated through a quantitative approach, through a qualitative approach, with specific surveys or with big surveys, or by using pre-existing data or by using data that are collected ad hoc. So those are challenges that are have to be included in the framework if you want really to measure resilience. Therefore, we came out by creating this resilience index measurement and analysis, which, as I said, started in 2008 to 2009, and we have improved and changed a lot all over the years. And now we have this that we call RIMA 2. Hopefully, Rocky, successful like Rocky. So, and basically, the idea is to have a tool who can allow explaining why and how some households cope with shocks and stressors better than other households can do, and can provide rigorous framework for humanitarian and long-term development initiatives. As you know, there are many different definitions of resilience, and we make sure that our RIMA could fit with many different definitions of resilience. We are just mentioning here three of the most used and adopted resilience, and we cannot omit to remember that you should you can use as reference all the work that has been done by the Resilience Measurement Technical Working Group since 2013 up to now, with a lot of with many guidelines, with many very useful papers and notes. An aspect of RIMA which is very fundamental to me that I want to mention is that we are household oriented. Why is that? Well, FAO by mandate is much interested in food security. And if you look at security as a system, the entry point for food security is the household, because the household is the place where all the key decisions are taken. The household is the place where all the decisions in a moment, in a crisis moment, are taken, where all the behavior are adopted, and where, for example, the choice between asset smoothing or consumption smoothing are taken. Therefore, household is our unit of interest. That is, the household is the unit where the positive and negative effects of shocks or interventions take place. So this is our unit of analysis. And I'm stressing this because if you are interested in household resilience, then you have to look at household surveys. So this is our point of interest. This is our conceptual framework, which was designed together with Professor Donato Romano. So I will quickly guide you through the conceptual framework. You have basically two moments, time zero and time one. This is the difference between time zero and time one is as long as you want. There is a baseline, a follow-up, there is a 1 year and 2 years, so whatever is the distance. There is a time zero, so there is a baseline moment where a household has a certain level of an outcome of interest. That is our why in this case, in the top part of the slide. And then you have a certain level of resilience. And we see resilience as composed by access to basic services, assets, social safety nets, and adaptive capacity. So these four key pillars of resilience are overlapping with other possible definitions of the dimension of resilience, like the one that the Resilience Measurement Technical Working Group provided with. So it's just that we are interested in looking at these aspects of resilience capacity. So we have disaggregated the resilience in these four components. And then, of course, there is a certain level of household time variant and household time invariant characteristics. Then what happens? Something happens. A shock can arrive. Think about whatever, a conflict. Think about a geographical shock, a meteorological shock, or something else that destroys the situation in time zero. A certain set of coping strategies enter into action. There may be consumption smoothing, there may be asset smoothing, there may be the adoption of new livelihoods, there may be the intervention of external subjects. And we arrive to a new level of both why and resilience. That is to say, we can arrive to another level of food security and we can arrive to another level of resilience capacity. Why I'm saying this? Because we may have a loss in food security and maybe we can have a third data collection which reports a recover in food security level. And this is a key aspect for us to understand what happened, what were the main determinants of this recovery in food security. At the same time, our resilience capacity can be deteriorated. If you think about what is being reached by one shock in 5 years or being reached by five shocks in 5 years are two completely different set of situations. And of course, our capacity of resilience can be deteriorated over time. So this is our conceptual framework. This is where we started from. And this is what we want to be able to measure. As you may see, in the direct measurement of resilience, shocks and food security indicators are not directly included. This is a key part of our renovated RIMA 2. Why is that? Because we consider shocks as exogenous to the resilience measurement. That is to say, shocks are able to negatively influence resilience, to reduce our resilience capacity, to reduce our food security level, but we need to keep them outside of the estimation of our resilience index, because otherwise we cannot run a causal analysis. Same applies to food security. Food security indicators are the outcomes of a resilient household. That is to say, if my household is resilient to a shock, if I am a pastoral and we receive the drought and my household is resilient to drought, this means that I will be able to meet my food security needs in the next future. If I do am resilient, then I will have good food security indicators. And therefore, if I want to measure my resilience capacity, I technically need to have food security variables outside because they are the outcome of interest. They are the why of our equation. It is much important for us to include all the different aspects, all the different shocks that can affect one household. And there are, broadly speaking, two types of shocks. Those shocks who are, I will not mention, those shocks who are affecting directly the household, which I don't know how they are called technically, and and are just household specific. And then there may be shocks that are affecting the entire community. And in this case, they may be climate shocks, for example, drought, flood, or earthquake, or whatever else, the tsunami, and there may be conflict shocks. Even in this case, I don't know the technical name, so I will not mention. There is something written here, which I don't read, however. What type of data are we using when we do the resilience analysis, when we do the RIMA analysis? Well, basically, we can employ quantitative data and qualitative data. And in the case of quantitative data, we can have both existing data and ad hoc data. We tend to go for already existing data when we are lucky enough to have a statistically valid and significant database already existent in the country or in the area where we are going to do the resilience analysis. So if I think about the LSMS from the World Bank, the MIX from UNICEF, the dataset from the VAM from WFP, So, exactly, as well as many of the other household budget survey coming from the National Bureau of Statistics in different areas or regions. When we have to do the data collection ourselves, as we are doing in Somalia, as we did in Mauritania, as we are doing in other countries, then we can design the baseline and the final survey for impact evaluation, and we can design everything else. But what is very much important for us is the integration with qualitative data. Qualitative data cannot tell the entire side and the entire aspects, the entire, let's say, concept of resilience. So we need a qualitative assessment. And when we do that in data collection ourselves, we follow this approach, which was designed by us from FAO together with colleagues from WFP and UNICEF, which is a mixed method approach for collecting data. So basically, we use a qualitative data collection to design our questionnaire, our quantitative questionnaire. Then we do the quantitative data collection itself with a household survey, and then we can get back there with other consultation, focus group discussion in order to inform our analysis to make sure that we have correctly included all the different aspects. And I never forget to mention an example coming from two neighboring districts in Somalia where with our qualitative assessment, we were asking people how to define resilience, and they were providing us five different definitions of resilience, and only one was overlapping, because it's very complicated to be context specific, and unless you don't do a proper qualitative analysis, there is no real way how you can make it. Let's now see how is the RIMA 2 composed. RIMA 2 is divided in two broad measures. The first one is the measure that we call descriptive measure. The second one is the measure that we call causal measure. The descriptive measure provides information on the household resilience capacity. So it provides a description of the household resilience capacity index and the resilience structure metrics. This can be used as a policy analysis tool and can be used in order to inform funding and policy decision, and it allows the targeting and the ranking of households from the most to the less resilient. As I was mentioning before, we see resilience pillars as composed by four key aspects: access to basic services, assets, social safety nets, and adaptive capacity. Here we have the definitions of these four pillars, where adaptive capacity is the ability of a household to adapt to a new situation. The social safety nets pillars measure the ability of a household to access assistance provided by international agencies, charities, and NGOs. While asset is included, is composed by both productive and non-productive assets. So this can include a long list of different indicators. And finally, there is access to basic services. So which is the idea? The overall idea is this one. We can start from observed variables that we can collect for each of these four pillars. So for example, in access to basic services, we can have the distances to services, we can have the quality of the services, we can have the frequency of the service provision. And for assets, we can have both productive and non-productive assets. We can include all the different aspects that can generate income, as well as more urban-oriented assets and more rural-oriented assets. In the social safety nets, we include both formal and informal safety nets, which includes cash for work, includes different cash transfer projects, so as well as it includes also the social networks, the informal social networks, so the number of, associations they can rely on, or whether a household can send kids to live by family relatives in order to be able to cope with a sudden crisis. In the adaptive capacity, we include a list of indicators of variables that can be used as proxy for the capacity of adapting to a new situation. That is to say, I am a pastoralist. A drought can, or a disease can kill all my livestock. Am I able to adapt to this situation and to go with a new livelihood system or not? So we include a number of different indications. Once we obtain these variables, we put them together through factor analysis, and we obtain, finally, through a structural equation model, a value for our latent variable that we call resilience. And this is the way we create our resilience capacity index. Of course, when you do latent gradient variable analysis, you cannot do a proper causal analysis. That is to say, you cannot use latent variable models to say to attribute the specific relevance of one single, for example, investment in one specific aspect to the final outcome. So we had to move our analysis into a regression under a regression framework. So that's why we created this second measure of resilience, where RIMA 2 map estimates the main determinants of food recovery, of food security recovery, and moving the resilience analysis under a long-term perspective. So as I was mentioning before, just look at this graph here, and this is exactly what we are interested in. So we have, this graph is taken by an analysis that we did in Uganda with the Uganda panel data set from the World Bank. So we have three rounds of surveys, 2010, 11, 12. We had a certain level of food security in 2010, and then a subsample of this population saw its resilience, food security level decreased in 2011. And a subsample of this population managed to recover between 2011 and 2012. So that's our case study. That's our population of interest. We are interested in understanding what are the main determinants that made sure that these households were able to recover the food security. And this is exactly where we can run our regression analysis. So we can do profit model or whatever else a model is needed in order to follow exactly, specifically, this subsample population, finding out what are the main determinants of this recovery. In this case, this is the final example that I'm giving you on this. In the bottom part of this slide, you may see this three this figure, this blue figure here, where we have the three main determinants of food security recovery. That is agricultural assets, infrastructural index, and distance to market. That is to say, those are the three major contributors to the food security recovery of this household. And this is exactly our capacity of predicting where, if I invest my last dollar, what is the return in terms of resilience increase. As Luca was mentioning at the beginning of this presentation, we are putting a lot of efforts in moving our very nice and very fancy time approach from a more academic perspective to a more concrete perspective, stepping up our capacity of influencing policy design. By this point of view, there are a number of things that I wanted to mention to you. We are proceeding, integrating and harmonizing our resilience analysis, our RIMA, with other tools. And I was just to mention some of them here. For example, the USA Tango approach. For example, all the exercises that we are doing together with our UNICEF colleagues. We are discussing together with the colleagues from MIX, that is the survey that UNICEF does very frequently, in order to broaden a little bit the mix coverage, so that we can run resilience analysis out of the mix, which we already did in the example of Mali. We are continuing having meetings with the WSP colleague in order to adopt RIMA as an indicator of impact evaluation, and also in order to integrate RIMA with other existing tools like ICA from WFP, another example of the jobs that our colleagues are doing. And especially, for example, we are now currently doing a resilience analysis with a WFP dataset in Chad. Sorry. And also we are integrating together with IFAD the team by working strictly, working with the colleagues here in Rome in IFAD in order to adopt RIMA as impact evaluation. At the same time, we are also trying to broaden our Riemann analytical capacities. We are internally in FAO running an exercise in order to include the gender perspective in RIMA, which is already included because we always do a disaggregation by gender, but we know that we can do much better, so we are currently hiring another resource in order to help us with our gender expert colleagues here in FAO in order to help us doing it better. And we are also continuing talking about this with our UNICEF colleagues that are undergoing a similar exercise in Dakar. We are including as much as we can the shocks perspective. So we are working in collaboration with IFPRI, we are working in collaboration with the Cornell and Tufts University in order to broaden our capacity of detecting shocks, which is not easy because sometimes the data sets are not there. We are then implementing this resilience marker in West Bank and Gaza Strip. Basically, the resilience marker will be able to mark different projects on their contribution to resilience in to household resilience. And we are piloting in Somalia what we will call a crisis REMA, that is to say a very rapid assessment tool that will enable people to assess the resilience capacity under by using just 5 or 10 key variables that can be assessed very quickly in passing through villages or passing through a very sudden crisis situation. And finally, we are exploring the possibility of creating a global resilience index for future comparisons. Another thing that I want to mention, and this is my last slide, and I'm happy to see that there are many questions, and boss, there are 75 users, so my family worked well in increasing the number of participants. So can I call my father and tell him it's enough? So we are a very much important collaboration with the SILS and IGAD is ongoing in both Sahel and Horn of Africa. So we set up two resilience analysis units, one in Nairobi and one in Dakar, so that we can interact with these two regional initiatives, and we can be present in the field, and we can do resilience analysis there. We are working very strictly with the National Bureau of Statistics, and all our analyses are very much focused on collaboration with them. And as much as we can, we try to do an handover of our technology. That is to say, we make sure that we train statisticians from the National Bureau of Statistics so that they can do the analysis themselves. And every possibility of interaction by this point of view is absolutely welcome. Also, we are working together with country regional, sub-regional, country regional and sub-regional offices from FAO, but I will also add the UNICEF and WC, as I was mentioning before, because we truly think that the only way is to work all together so that we can improve our skill and our resilience and measurement tool. This is also an ongoing idea of broadening and collaborating with other initiatives in Latin America, no? If I'm not wrong. So there will be possibilities of working there as well, and it's hopefully. And also something which I like so much, which I care so much, is the collaboration with university, especially universities from the country. So from African countries, when we are working in Africa, or from possibly also West Bank and Gaza Strip, or wherever else we will find ourselves working. That is to say, having young statisticians, econometricians working with us in improving our capacities, and at the same time, learning how to run resilience by themselves. And of course, we are also pursuing collaboration with American universities and other universities in Italy or elsewhere in Europe. A very general statement which will conclude my intervention here is that we are rethinking our resilience analysis and communication tools under a much more policy-oriented perspective, which is exactly what we are looking for. So to make sure that we are able to say if we are spending our money in the right way, and if we are achieving our task, that is to say, raising resilience capacity to food security. And this concludes this presentation. Please sign up to our newsletter, and I'm not quite sure how this move on now. I mute. Okay.